And joining us now in studio, Louise Arbour, President and CEO of the International Crisis Group. Hello, thank you for coming in. And I should thank you even more because I know your voice is going on you, so thank you for coming in and talking to us. Before we delve into our topic tonight, I know there are a lot of students out there, a lot of practicing young lawyers who dream of the kinds of jobs that you have been able to have. You have been prosecutor internationally, you have been a Supreme Court Justice here in Canada. I want to rewind though. I want to go back to the time when you were 24 years old. You were a law clerk at the Supreme Court of Canada. What got you interested in the justice system?
I don't know actually, and I'm, again, let me apologize for my voice. This is too much airplane and not enough fluids, apparently. I don't know what brought me into the legal profession. There are no lawyers in my family. I went to law school more or less by default, but I found a very good fit right from the beginning.
From there, you had so many different careers, nationally and internationally, all within the justice system, but perhaps you're best known for Chief Prosecutor for the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda and the former Yugoslavia. You didn't know why you got into the legal profession, I guess, at first, but once you got in there, was international justice a goal for you?
No. In fact, I'd never thought of it. And my field was really criminal law, not international law. And it would have never occurred to me until it happened that there would be a kind of Nuremberg effort. Again, it had been 50 years since war criminals had been prosecuted at Nuremberg and in Tokyo. And then when the UN Security Council set up these tribunals, I was astounded to see this opening field of international criminal law. It was not even a field, it was just an experiment, basically. So when I was approached to do it, I was stunned.
You've served as a justice on our Supreme Court here in Canada, and it's really your expertise from that position that involves our discussion today. Earlier this spring, you wrote an opinion piece in the Globe and Mail on the occasion of the Charter's 30th anniversary. And you wrote in that piece that the enactment of the Charter on Rights and Freedoms may have been the most significant political event of post-World War II Canada. Why did you say that?
Well, because I think the enactment of the Charter completely readjusted the branches of governance. It gave courts the power of judicial oversight over the validity, the constitutional validity of legislation, which we had never had before. So not only was it an opening for the enforcement of fundamental human rights, but it was also a complete readjustment of the kind of balance of power between the executive, the legislative, and the judicial branch.
I guess arguably the Canadian Bill of Rights was an instrument to do some of the things that the Charter ultimately arguably managed to accomplish. Why though do you think that the Bill of Rights fell short?
Well, precisely because it was not a constitutional document. It was just another law that was providing a kind of a model for interpretation to courts. And judges, the Supreme Court in particular, when I was there as a law clerk, were the early days of the Bill of Rights. The Supreme Court was very timid, very deferential to Parliament, still a very traditional concept that democracy means just electoral democracy, therefore rule by the majority, which is then very difficult to accommodate minority rights in that environment. So the court under the Bill of Rights was very timid, and the Bill of Rights as a legal instrument did not give the court the kind of powers that the Charter did.
Didn't have the teeth.
Didn't have the teeth because it was not a super law as the Constitution is. The Charter is inside the Constitution, so it overrides other legislation.
I'm putting forth your argument about why you see the Charter as such a fundamental not only document but living thing in our democracy. You kind of put forth three reasons why you saw it as such, and one of them was very debatable, section 33, the notwithstanding clause. Legal purists might not have accepted it at first, at least with open arms. Why do you see it as such a key to the Charter's success?
I think it allowed the courts to fully embrace their mandate, because the safety net of the ultimate decision going back to elected officials was there. As you know, the notwithstanding clause permits Parliament or the provincial legislatures basically to override Charter rights. So if the court pronounced a decision that politicians felt was unacceptable, they can essentially reverse the Supreme Court, but the price they have to pay is they have to acknowledge that what they do essentially is a violation of the Charter. So it's a very clever...
And seldomly used in...
Very rarely, essentially just by Quebec, for the most part on language laws. But I think it allowed the courts to go, to push the envelope, not to have to be too deferential to legislatures, because at the end they could interpret the Charter in a very rigorous way and say, well, if that's not acceptable to the politicians, they could use the notwithstanding clause. So in a sense, it allowed the courts, I think, to fully embrace their mandate.
To perhaps be a little freer?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, another factor you say contributed to the Charter's central role in our democracy is the idea of the 3-year moratorium on equality rights. How did this affect the scope of judicial review, or how has it?
Well, I think what it did, first of all, it must have been very disappointing to equality seekers, you know, to have the non-discrimination provision of the Charter, a very central human rights provision, not come into effect immediately. Again, the idea was to give the Parliament and the provincial legislatures some time to correct their legislation. So rather than have a flood of cases, the legislatures could sit down, look at laws that may appear discriminatory and just fix them. A very clever idea. Give them 3 years to do that. It also had the benefit, which I'm not sure was anticipated, that the first cases that came to the courts were not equality cases, which are hard cases. Mm. So the first cases that came before the judges were very familiar cases. You know, the right to counsel in a criminal case. I don't know, the right to an interpreter. So it allowed the court to start using the Charter in a very comfortable environment.
Get used to it.
Yeah, and get used to it in a field in which they were very at ease. You know, judges are very at ease in criminal procedure cases, police powers, wiretap, restraining the methods of obtaining confessions. All this was, judges used to do that at common law. Now, to do it under the Charter was not very different. But if the first case that had hit the court had been something like, mandatory retirement at age 65 unconstitutional, judges might have been very taken aback by having to decide that kind of issue. So I think it allowed the courts to kind of ease themselves into constitutional interpretation in a familiar way.
Independent of the Charter is the Court Challenges Program, known as the CCP. Tell me, what does this program do? Because I don't think most Canadians, myself included, are very familiar with it.
Well, as I understand it, it's no longer in existence. I think the present government has abolished it. Basically, what it did is it provided funding for organizations like LEAVE, for instance, Legal Education in Action Fund, which was a great advocate for women's equality. It allowed funding. So cases might have been able to come to court, you know, with pro bono lawyers, but it essentially gave, I think, the Canadian public the tools to access the court in the same way that you can access Parliament. So I think it provided assistance, and as a result of that, there was excellent, really good quality litigation. For instance, on the understanding of equality, you know, moving from a very traditional sense of formal equality to substantive equality. All this, I think, was very well supported by this program.
What have we lost now that CCP's gone, then?
Well, there's some that argue that all the basic framework is now in place. And I still think litigation is so expensive, and access to courts is still so problematic, that these kinds of public interest litigation issues should have some public funding support, because the case benefits not just the immediate parties, it benefits whole classes of people.
I want to read you a quote. You are no stranger to knowing that there are a lot of critics of the Charter. I want to read a bit of what author William Gairdner had to say about the Charter. This comes actually from back in 2007, but let's hear a little bit of what he wrote. He said, "The invention of a Charter and rights and of pardon me, the invention of a Charter of Rights and Freedoms was a backward step that returned Canadians to the kind of political condition they endured under their British masters during the colonial period. The emphasis since 1982 has shifted from the question of what laws the people wish their elected representatives to make to the question of what laws their judges will allow them to make. In this way, he writes, Canada has been changed, uprooted, altered beyond recognition from its noble historical roots. That is the real significance of the Charter. Okay, Louise, what do you make of that argument?
Well, the one thing one can say is certainly not backwards. There was no such protection under British imperial rule. So I think in terms of legal analysis, it's completely wrong. Now, what I think this supposes is that, first of all, that the Charter, which is part of the Canadian Constitution, is not a democratically enacted document. A lot of people in Quebec would agree with that. Elsewhere, I think we have to say, Canadians came together and enacted a constitution, part of which contains the Charter, which is designed to balance this majority rule, which is very much the essence of democracy, with the majority's commitment to putting limits on its ability to ignore minority views or entitlements. So I think, in fact, not only is it not a step backwards, a very modern document, which is now also, I think, the model in Western Europe, has been the model in the United States for a century. So it's very much a step forward, and I think it has provided, in a country like Canada, where there are many forms of minority entitlements, from Aboriginal groups to cultural and linguistic minorities, has provided them with tools to be fully participant in political life.
We're going to talk a little bit about the Canadian model and where it might be emulated in other parts of the world. But just before we get to that, I want to ask you, you know, throughout your career in the Canadian justice system, you have urged courts at all levels to be more attentive to social and economic rights. What did you see, at least at the time, that was so unsatisfactory about the enforcements of these rights?
Well, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, enacted by the United Nations in 1948, was a very comprehensive document, and it spoke of human rights very broadly, civil and political rights, and also economic and social rights and cultural rights. So not only the right not to be arbitrarily arrested and imprisoned, not to be treated in a cruel and unusual fashion and so on, but also the right to health, the right to education, the right to shelter. This was all part of the vision that human dignity required protection and advancement of all these rights. Shortly after, basically at the beginning of the Cold War, there was a very big fracture in the human rights framework. All Western countries, Canada in particular, became champions of civil and political rights and felt that economic and social rights were not really rights. They would be the byproducts of a prosperous democracy. On the other hand, the communist countries purported to champion economic and social rights, but not civil and political rights. And this fracture has remained. Now it has changed between, still the Western countries are not very keen on economic and social rights, and the developing countries are. They want money to advance, right to health, right to education. But they're not very keen to talk about political freedom, freedom of assembly, freedom of speech, free press. So the fracture is still very much there.
Why is that, though, in the West? Why is there this, I don't know if you'd call it a reluctance, or what's behind, what would you say is behind this idea that they don't
want? I think it's part of the kind of economic political system. The belief that, the marketplace will look after, you know, prosperity will lift all boats, and that these things will be looked after, and that the distribution of wealth is a matter of political decision, not entitlement. So it's still very much part, you know, less so in more socialist regimes, but essentially that's still the view.
So have you seen better access, improvement in areas such as access to education, food and shelter in Canada?
Yes. Well, I think there have been advances, but the alleviation of poverty, you know, to the extent that it is not anchored in a constitutional entitlement enforceable by courts, it will remain anchored in principles that are more based on a kind of charitable model. kind of, you know, you have to look after people, but then again, only when they deserve it. So it's very judgmental. It's based more on kind of moral values than on a real sense that as a human being, people have some fundamental basic entitlement to turn to each other through the state for their survival, basically, and for their, you know, intellectual advancement through education.
Some would argue that maybe we're still hung up because of the federal-provincial divide and how social freedoms might be better addressed if we weren't so hung up on that. Do you agree with that?
Well, I think, again, the Charter has recentered the debate. We used to fight these same issues, but before we had the Charter, they were always phrased in tensions between federal and provincial powers. Now, at least, we're talking about the real issues. It doesn't mean that we always agree on the answers, but I think the kind of federal-provincial division of power has faded a bit on these kinds
faded
of issues.
Enough?
Well, it remains a very important feature, I think. Canadian federalism is very unique. I think has served Canadians well. The Charter, I think, has put a completely different gloss on how to address some of these issues.
You raised the word unique, that the Charter's unique. But it seems to me, anyway, that around the world, and it seems to you, because you've made the argument, that other countries are emulating this. In fact, a recent Washington University study of the world's constitutions concluded that it is the Canadian Constitution that has become more appealing as a model than the U.S. Do you see evidence of that in your work?
Yeah, I think we shouldn't confuse the Canadian Constitution as a whole and the Charter. The Canadian Constitution, of course, is based on the principle of federalism, and it's a particular form of federalism. Decentralization, certainly, if we talk about federalism now, I think is increasingly a viable option for the management of countries that have a lot of differences, you know, that don't work very well in a centralized way. But I think what these authors are talking about is the constitutional protection of fundamental rights, which certainly when I was in law school, whenever it was, 40 years ago, we would turn to the U.S. Supreme Court for guidance because Canadian courts didn't have these kinds of powers. Now I think there's a real sense of politicization of the U.S. Supreme Court. And in contrast, the way the Supreme Court of Canada in particular has interpreted the Charter has been very much in line, not just in line at the forefront of, I think, very sophisticated judicial work in South Africa, in India, and in several other countries where judges have started to articulate all the contours of their power of judicial review of legislation. And Canada's definitely on that ground, very progressive.
Do you think that we are the model that other countries, especially burgeoning democracies, should emulate to try and emulate our democratic institutions?
I think constitutional models are very difficult to export. We should never look at it from a Canadian point of view. Certainly in the work I do with the International Crisis Group, if we have a mantra, it's that everything is contextual. You cannot come with a kind of a toolbox of solutions for political problems elsewhere. You have to really understand a country's history, the current political tensions, the actors, the power bases, and then you could borrow from different models of centralization, decentralization, balance of power between a lot of emerging democracies, in my opinion, put too much emphasis on executive powers, particularly those that go with the presidential model. It's still the kind of strongman culture.
Like which democracy, burgeoning
democracy? Oh, I think many African countries, for instance, have continued this kind of presidential model. There's an enormous concentration of power in the presidency. And then the legislatures are elected, but pretty lame. And the judicial power is virtually non-existent. Judges are under-trained, under-qualified, under-valued. So I think this redress needs to take place.
Louise Arbour, thank you for coming in and talking with me today.
It's my pleasure.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.